Amen. And we have to resist things like that. We have to resist the devil. If we resist him, the Bible says that he will flee. It says he will flee. You don't have to go anywhere. All you have to do is resist him. Binding and loosing. I'm reminded of last week we also talked about, you know, how about, you know, casting out demons a little bit. Exorcism, as a Christian, as the Catholic Church calls it. I think we call it casting out devils. They call it exorcism. And most of us have seen the movies that refer to, you know, the exorcist, the exorcism of Emily Rose is one out there, the Omen, all those things that deal with demonic forces. Those movies, you know, they portray things falling, the movie Fallen, they portray things a little different, but it's real, okay? It's really real. Spiritual wickedness is real in the world. Amen. And like I said, I shared last Sunday or Sunday before last how, you know, I was possessed by a spirit that controlled me in my life of drugs. This was a spirit attached to me. And I had to be delivered from that spirit. Amen. And to show you just how real that spirit is, that spirit is so powerful that it can just come into your presence, that same spirit that you used to be with, and it'll get back on you, in you. You're a familiar place for it. And it'll get back in you just like that. That's why you have to make sure that you stay away from certain people, places, and things once God delivers you from something. Amen? Because it's always ready, willing, and able to get right back in the comfort zone, you, where it come from. Amen? I remember we was young in the ministry. We had been in the ministry probably about maybe 5 years at the most. And we had to deal with our first demonic possession. Some people call it exorcism. And it happened on a Thanksgiving holiday. We were sitting, eating with the family, and I got a call that I needed to come to the church and meet some folk immediately. And we just got through eating, you know, come on somebody, eating all good, dressing and ham and sweet potato pie, and now we finna go fight the devil. Not so. Not so, amen. Little to our, we weren't afraid of the devil, but little to our naivete, we came in here thinking we going to cast something out, but that didn't happen that way. Are y'all with me? The Bible's really clear about something, some kind, only go out by fasting and praying. And we just got through gorging ourselves on some food, amen? And we came in here, and that devil just clowned on the altar floor. Did that. Okay, I really can't explain to you. You'd had to been there to see it. So it was four of us that night. Five of us. We started with five ministers. And but we ended up with four. One of them quit on us and said, man, look, we went to the house and stuff went to happening at the house. And this minister said, hey, man, I ain't going back, man. I appreciate that. That's real stuff. But I said, man, no problem. Don't worry about it. Because if you're afraid, then you're going to be a hindrance to the whole team. So I said, man, don't worry about it. We'll take care of it. But that's just to show you, okay, how demonic activity was just revealing itself. Okay. I mean, this demon was speaking ancient languages and moving all kind of different ways and doing, oh yeah, contortions, and I can see how her body was doing certain movements that she was making. And but we girded ourselves up. We realized that we needed to fast and pray. We fast and prayed for 3 days. And we just told them, said, look, this is a little beyond us right now. We need to go and regroup. You know, I just kept it real with him. I said, look, man, I thought, you know, this ain't no imp, man. This is some ancient demon you're dealing with, partner. And we need to gird up, man. And so we 3 days later, we went back, and you know, we dealt with it. We got the girl delivered. Amen. Amen. But it is very, very real. Very real. And eventually, I had to ask him. I said, "Man, why did you, you know, why you call me?" He said, "Man, I had got with the, I went to the Ministry of Lions, and they told, they said, well, they told me to come see you." Amen. He said, "They told me to come see you because they didn't really know about dealing with demonic spirits and stuff like that." Amen. So I guess that's a testament to our spirituality here, that other folk can recognize that we stand a better chance of dealing with spirits than some other people. I say to you, and I say that I tell you that story for this purpose. Demonic activity is very real, and the people that don't believe in it are susceptible to it. Are y'all with me? The biggest trick the enemy ever pulled was to make folk believe he did not exist. So if something don't exist, you're not going to be looking for it. Come on, somebody. So you better know that evil spirits exist, and they're coming after us all the time, in all different kind of ways. Amen.
Let me share a story of one that I actually saw in our home years ago. Carrie was what, senior in high school, getting ready to go to the military, and we were in the bed. And I literally saw, you know how y'all watch movies and you see the evil, on movies, you can see an evil spirit like a screen, a smoke, or smoke, black, dark. Because I was in the bed, he was sleeping, I was sitting there, and where our bedroom was here, and Carrie's was across the hall, and Kelsey was over there. And I was just reading something, and I said, you know how you can see something out of your peripheral? I was going to say, Carrie, what you doing? Because it was going to Carrie's room. In Carrie's room. But I didn't. But I knew it was something. Went on to sleep, got a phone call. It was the West Memphis Police Department. Carrie, Mom, I'm sorry, Mom. I'm like, what? What you mean? You sorry? You ain't in the room? He just snuck out the window. We sleep. Snuck out the window. Got himself into some trouble with some drugs. Scared, crying. There was that evil spirit going in their room because he around people, place, and thing. And I recognized, I saw it because I could see stuff. And I'm sorry, he was getting ready to go to the military. He was crying, scared. He wasn't going to be able to do it. And the woman, you know, we just fasted and prayed, and that thing lifted. Because they said, there's no way I can't take this. She not tell us that. I can't get this removed from your record. She told her, I can't do this. But he went on the military. He went on. But she said, there's nothing I can do. I can't do it. You did this. But they saw something in him. They saw us, and we were trying to raise him right. He was crying. Y'all know Kerry. He just wanted to be a thug. He ain't no thug. He just wanted to be one. But he was just crying in front of the people at the juvenile court in West Memphis. And they expunged it, and he went on. But I'm telling y'all, them spirits, I saw that thing. It was just like, it was a smoke, like a screen, like the screens on your window, but like moving and forming, moving like a wind, like you could see a dark wind. I saw that. I was about to say, Carrie, what you doing? Because it was late, but there's the evil spirit going in his room, and it got on him, and he went out that window. Like, what? You done went out your window, crying. He done called, crying. But I'm telling y'all, that stuff, we be watching all that evil stuff. I grew up watching those scary movies. I loved them, but now, Annabelle, yeah, we did go see Annabelle. But, I'm talking about the old Annabelle, not this one. But I recognize, I know, this stuff is real. So y'all be mindful, y'all better steal them cracks and crevices with that oil.
Amen. The best way I guess I can explain what she said, spirits are not physical things, but they what they call metaphysical. Things that are metaphysical can actually affect the physical, but they are not physical, if it makes sense. But they can affect the physical. Amen? And what she saw was because of her spiritual discernment. Other people would never saw it. Are y'all with me? But because of her spiritual discernment, she was able to see it. Amen. One thing I've learned when it comes to spiritual things, okay, is that you have to always pause when you come upon a spiritual issue or a spiritual something that's very evil. You have to always pause and let God reveal to you what needs to be done, because sometimes it's not about you, and you don't need to do anything. Are y'all still with me? Sometimes you will see something that has nothing to do with you. Are y'all with me? There's nothing that you should do about that, because evil spirits are in the earth. They've been here from the ancient times, way before we got here, and they're going to be here probably when we're gone. Amen. But what we have to realize is that it's a constant war between good and evil going on each and every day. And we have to decide every day when we get up which side of that war we're going to be on. Good side or the evil side. Come on, somebody. You're never in the middle. You're on one side or the other. And the fight is not for your stuff. The fight is not for what you got. It's not for physical things. The enemy just wants your soul. That's all he wants is your soul. That's the only thing that's valuable to him. In fact, that's the only thing really valuable to God. This body, he's already condemned it to return to the dust. He don't want this body. All he wants is your soul, because that's the only thing that's still pure to him. That's the only thing that's still of value to him. Amen. So we spend so much time trying to preserve the body, which is already condemned to the grave. Are y'all with me? Huh? But we still should be really spending all our time trying to preserve our soul, to keep our souls, keep ourselves holy and unspotted and unblemished. Are y'all with me? Because this is really what God wants, our souls. Amen? What is my soul? My mind, my will, and my emotions. And if you can be honest with yourself, your soul has transitioned from when you were young to now you're old. Now you don't even mind the same things that you did when you were young. Come on, somebody. Paul said, when I was a child, I spoke as a child, I thought as a child, I did childish things, but now I've become a man, I put away childish things. Are y'all with me? Amen. So your soul consists of your experiences. A lot of time I look back on my experiences in my life and things that I've come through, and my soul gets glad. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. My soul gets glad. Not my mind, not my heart. My soul gets glad. My soul leaps because of what God has done for me and all the dangers he brought me out of, seen and unseen. Come on, somebody. I should have been dead. But God, amen. Hallelujah. Last week, we opened up with Luke 12. It says that, look, don't fear man that can just destroy the body. Jesus said, fear he who can destroy both the body and soul in hell. Amen. So we must begin to get a healthy fear for hell, because hell is a real place. People going there every day. Heaven is a real place. People going there every day. Are y'all with me? But we must make sure that we don't become complacent as Christians and think that, you know, we all going to go to heaven because we go to church, or because we read the Bible, because we in the choir, because we preach the scriptures. No, none of that is evidence that you going to heaven. Are y'all with me? Because at the end of the day, and as many funerals that we've been to, some of us been to more than others, but we've all been to funerals. Amen? And I ain't never been to a funeral that the preacher put the person in hell. Come on, somebody. Come on now. Now, I assure you, some of the funerals we went to, folk didn't go to hell. Are y'all with me? Okay? Regardless of what the preacher said, regardless of what the folk that had a testimony said, regardless of the songs that were sang, okay? People are going to hell. The scriptures declare that it has even enlarged itself. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. But I'm going to share this with you. I had a vision, an open-eye vision. I hadn't had a whole lot of them, but I had an open-eye vision of heaven once. And it was just a glimpse. And all I saw was these, I guess you would call them mountains, but they weren't rugged like mountains. Maybe they were just big hills, but they were all these big hills, pretty green hills, and all of them, I mean, as far as I could see, were just big, tall, pretty green hills, and all of them had a road that went around it in a spiral going to the top of it. And along this road was just big houses and mansions around every one of these hills. Amen. And I just caught a glimpse of that, and that just encouraged me. So it was so beautiful. I can't really describe how pretty it was, the lighting and all the light and all that. But it was a glimpse of heaven, and there are really literally mansions in heaven, like the Lord said. He said he'd go to prepare a place for you. Come on, somebody. And he told him, he said, there are many mansions in my Father's house. Amen. There are mansions. Like I tell folks, you might not live in a big house now, but when you get there's something prepared for you greater than anything you could imagine on this earth. And believe you me, we're gonna live with him. We're gonna be living. Are y'all with me? We're going to live with God, and God is going to be with us and be our God. We're going to live. Amen. We're going to enjoy life. Amen. I'm going to read a little bit tonight. I didn't bring my book. Where my book at? Go get my book for me. Thank you. The technical difficulties got me a little off today. I didn't bring my book. I want to read a little bit from this book tonight. I didn't get a chance to last week. But I want to read a little bit from this book called The Divine Revelation of Hell. I still encourage y'all to get this book. Read it at your leisure. I believe it'll be a blessing to you. It's a very good book. It's an easy book to read. It's not filled with a whole lot of big words, things like that kind of trip you up. It's very easy to read. Amen. Praise the Lord. Into Hell, this is the first chapter. It says in March, and bear with me because I'm not an excellent reader, but I'm going to do my best. In March 1976, while I was praying at home, I had a visit from the Lord Jesus Christ. I had been praying in the Spirit for days when all at once I felt the very presence of God. His power and his glory filled the house. A brilliant light illuminated the room where I was praying, and a sweet and wonderful feeling came over me. Lights flowed in billows, rolling and folding into one another and rolling over and out of each other. It was a spectacular sight, and then the voice of the Lord began to speak to me. He said, I am Jesus Christ, your Lord, and I wish to give you a revelation to prepare the saints for my return and to turn many to righteousness. The powers of darkness are real, and my judgments are true. So, my child, I will take you into hell by my Spirit, and I will show you many things which I want the world to know. I will appear to you many times. I will take your spirit out of your body and will actually take you into hell. I want you to write a book and tell of the visions and of all the things I reveal to you. You and I will walk through hell together, make a record of these things which were and are to come. My words are true, faithful, and trustworthy. I am that I am, and there is none besides me. Dear Lord, I cried out, what do you want me to do? My whole being wanted to cry out to Jesus to acknowledge his presence. The best I can describe it is to say love came over me. It was the most beautiful, peaceful, joyful, and powerful love I have ever felt. God's praises began to flow from me All at once, I wanted to give him my whole life to be used by him to help save people from their sin. I knew by his spirit that it actually was Jesus, the Son of God, who was there in the room with me. I cannot find words to express his divine presence, but I know that I know it was the Lord. Behold, my child, Jesus said, I am going to take you by my spirit into hell so that you may be able to make a record of the reality of it, to tell the whole world what that hell is real and to bring the lost out of darkness and into the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Instantly, my soul was taken out of my body. I went with Jesus up out of my room and into the sky. I knew all that was going on about me. I saw my husband and children asleep in our home below. It was as though I had died and my body was left behind on the bed while my spirit was going with Jesus up through the top of the house. It seemed as though the whole roof was rolled back and I could see my family asleep in their beds. I felt the touch of Jesus and he said, "Fear not, they will be safe." He knew my thoughts. I will try to be the best of my ability to tell you step by step what I saw and felt. Some of the things I did not understand. The Lord Jesus told me the meaning of most of them, but some things he did not tell me. I knew then, I know now that these things were really happening and only God could have shown them to me. Praise his holy name. People, believe me, hell is real. I was taken there by the Spirit many times during the preparation of this report. Soon, we were high into the heavens. I turned and looked at Jesus. He was full of glory and power, and such peace flowed from him. He took my hand and said, "I love you. Fear not, for I am with you." At that, he began to go even higher into the sky, and now I could see the earth below, protruding out of the earth and scattered in about in many places were funnels spinning around to a center point and then turning back again. These moved high above the earth and looked like a giant, dirty type of slinky that moved continuously. They were coming up from all over the earth. "What are these?" I asked the Lord Jesus as we came near to one. "These are the gateways to hell," he said. "We will go into hell through one of them." Immediately, we entered one of the funnels. Inside, it looked like a tunnel, spinning around and around and back again like a top. A deep darkness descended on us, and with the darkness came a smell so horrible, it took my breath away. Along the sides of this tunnel were living forms embedded in the wall. Dark gray in color, the forms moved and cried out to us as we passed. I knew without being told that they were evil. The forms could not move but were still attached to the walls. A horrible smell came from them and they screeched at us by the most awful cries. I felt an invisible evil force moving inside the tunnels. At times in the darkness, I could make out the forms. A dirty fog covered most of them. "Lord, what are these?" I asked as I held on tightly to Jesus' hand. He said, "These are the evil spirits ready to spew out on the earth when Satan gives the orders." As we were going down inside the tunnel, the evil forms laughed and called out to us. They tried to touch us, but could not because of the power of Jesus. The very air was polluted and dirty, and only the presence of Jesus kept me from screaming at the sheer horror. Oh yes, I had all my senses. I could hear, smell, see, feel, and even taste the evil in this place. If anything, my senses had become more sensitive, and the odor and filth almost made me sick. Screams filled the air as we came near the base of the tunnel. Piercing cries came up the dark tunnel to meet us. Sounds of all sorts filled the air. I could feel fear, death, and sin all around me. The worst odor I have ever smelled filled the air. It was the smell of decaying flesh, and it seemed to be coming from the very direction. Never on earth had I felt such evil or heard such cries of despair. Soon I would find that those were the cries of the dead and that hell was filled with their wails. I felt the gust of evil wind and a small suction force ahead of us. Lights like lightning or strobe flashes penetrated the black darkness and threw gray shadows on the walls. I could barely make out the form of something in front of me. I recoiled in shock when I realized that it was a large snake moving along ahead of us. As I continued to look, I saw those ugly snakes were slithering about everywhere. Jesus said to me, "We will soon enter the left leg of hell. Ahead, you will see great horror, pathetic sadness, and indescribable horror. Stay close to me, and I will give you strength and protection as we go through hell. The things you are about to see are a warning," he said. "The book you write will save many souls from hell. What you are seeing is real. Fear not, for I will be with you. At long last, the Lord and I were at the bottom of the tunnel. We stepped into hell. I will try to the best of my ability to tell you what I saw, and I will tell it in the order God gave it to me. Ahead of us, as far as I could see, were flying objects darting here and there. Groaning sounds and pitiful cries filled the air. Up ahead, I saw a dim light, and we began walking toward it. The path was a dry, powdery dirt. We were soon at the entrance to a small, dark tunnel. Some things I cannot put on paper. They were too awful to describe. The fear in hell could be tasted. And I knew if I had not been with Jesus, I would not make it back. In the writing of this, some of the things I saw, I do not understand. But the Lord knows all things, and he helped me understand most of what I saw. Let me warn you, don't go to that place. It is a horrid place of torments, excruciating pain, and eternal sorrow. Your soul will always be alive. The soul lives forever. It is the real you, and your soul will go to either heaven or hell. To those of you who think that hell is here on earth, well, you are right, it is. Hell is in the center of the earth, and there are souls in torment there night and day. There are no parties in hell, no love, no compassion, no rest, only a place of sorrow beyond your belief. Amen. Praise the Lord. We'll close there tonight. I will open up the altar as we always do. Tonight I want to open it up a little differently. I want to those to come that are experiencing something that you can't really explain, and sometimes spiritual things that you can't explain and are fearful of are demonic. And if you're experiencing some things, some strange things going on in your mind, in your home, or whatever, that you know are evil, and you really don't know what to do about them or how to really, you know, I want you to come to the altar because I want to pray for your discernment, because sometimes these things are coming to attack you, and because you really don't know, you're not really able to defend yourself. Are y'all with me? It's real. I see it happening all the time. The Lord has taken my discernment to a point to where when I really just get in a mode of just meditation and spiritual connotation in the Lord, you know, I can see people. And they don't look like themselves anymore when I look at them. I can see the spiritual influence on them. And I can literally see it. And sometimes it's a little frightening because you don't want to see it on certain people. Are y'all with me? You know, sometimes the giftings of God, you know, a yay and amen always, but sometimes, you know, there's a sacrifice that comes with having certain gifts. Amen. So sometimes even in services, I look out among the congregation and I can see certain spirits. Amen. On some of you. Amen. But I want us to get to a place where we can understand as Christians that even as a Christian, even a believer can be oppressed by a spirit. I don't believe a Christian, born again Christian, can really be possessed by a spirit, but I really believe that we can be oppressed. That means that a spirit can be on us, not necessarily in us, but on us. Are y'all with me? And we need to get that spirit off of us. Are y'all with me? It's a negative, evil influence that's on us. This is the influences that causes us, look, to love somebody and cuss them out at the same time. It's an evil influence. Are y'all still with me? Don't act like you ain't done some evil stuff in your life. I'm trying to explain to you why it happened. Evil influences on you, okay? That's why we've done a lot of things, even as Christians, that we know are right. It's just an evil influence on us. And because we wasn't in a spiritual mode at the time to really fight and deal with it, it overtook us. That's how we as Christians, the Bible said, he who is overtaken in a fault, that means that was an evil spirit that oppressed that person and caused them to do something, be something that they should not have been. Are y'all with me? And the Lord is saying, look, that soul is still good. All is not lost. Go and restore that person. Are y'all with me? They're not possessed. They're just oppressed. And they need some help to get the devil off of. So I said it to let you know, sometimes you can be in here and you can have the devil on you. Evil on you. Come on, somebody. And if you don't do anything to get it off, it will stay with you and go everywhere with you and wreak havoc. Wherever you go, it'll be wreaking havoc. And you just smiling and going dee-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da, and this little evil spirit on you, wreaking havoc on other folk's life. Mm-hmm. Amen. And now, don't nobody want to come to the altar. That's all right. If you're scared, then I hope it's a good godly fear of hell. And you don't have to come to the altar if you don't want to. If you're afraid to, don't come. Praise the Lord. But it is available to you, and the power of God is able to do all things, especially cast out devils, especially deliver you from demonic forces. And I don't want us to be naive. I don't want us to be naive. And to think just because, I mean, we come to church faithfully and we live for him, we study our Bible, but the devil is still after us. And it just only takes a little bit for him to be able to come into your life. It don't take a whole lot. Just a little bit. Just a little bit of sin, a little bit of I see, gives the devil right away to come in. Are y'all with me? Okay? Now, that being said, I will close the altar in Jesus' name, and I will pray and trust, amen, that you have received enough reverence and fear of God tonight that you will go and sin no more. That's all Jesus told the woman that was committed in adultery and was brought before him. That's all he said to her. He didn't give her no long lecture of, baby, you know, you don't need to be messing with these men and all this kind of stuff and all this. Would stay at the club. And he just said, go and sin no more. And that's all we have to do at any given point, to realize that we need to stop doing the thing and stop it. Just stop it. Come on, somebody. I ain't going to lie no more. Come on, somebody. I just ain't gonna cuss no more. I don't care how mad they make me. I ain't gonna cuss no more. That's something you got to make up in your mind, in your soul, in your spirit. Amen? Because if you don't do that, ain't no amount of oil I can put on you. And don't make no difference how eloquent I cast the devil out in speech. It ain't going to do no good. You got to make up in your mind, you're going to live for God. You're going to do what's right, regardless of what other folk do and what other folks say. Amen. Boom. Shakalaka. Thank you. I love you.
Amen. Praise God. Give God a hand praise. Amen. We're going to ask our supermen if they'll prepare the baptism pool as we get ready to take our convert to the water. Amen. And give Pastor a few minutes to dry off. Those of you that would like a copy of A Divine Revelation of Hell, you may go to Amazon. I think it was $8.95 if you would like your own copy. I guarantee you it is a great book to keep in your library. Amen. A few years ago, we took that journey in Boys to Men, and it is something that we will never forget. Amen. Amen. I see many of you don't want it. Amen. Praise God. If you don't want to pay $8.95, guess what? You can get the ebook. Amen. And you can keep up with us in your phone or your tablet. Praise God. Amen. I don't have no readers in the house tonight. Or y'all done already left and went home, one of the two. Amen. Amen. Thank God for our convert on tonight. Praise God. Well, amen. Amen. We're going to ask our media to give us some music as we prepare. Oh, just keep talking. Amen. I'm so glad I got a good I'm so glad I'm so glad you know my feet's been taken out the marrow it's in my heart. Well, I got a good, it's in my heart. Oh, I got a good, it's in my heart. Oh, I got a good, you know my feet taken out tomorrow. Glad. One day, well, I went out to pray. You know my feet's been taken out tomorrow.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We're here to amen, to amen, baptize our brother in commandment of the Lord. And we're going to read the scripture that the Lord left the disciples. And in Matthew's gospel, the 28th chapter, beginning with verse 18, it says, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power was given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. We want to point out one thing that we must begin to do as a body of believers here. If we just can't be a church that just baptizes people. Are y'all with me? The scripture says in verse 19 that we should baptize them. But in verse 20 it says teaching them. Amen. So after we baptize them, we have a responsibility to teach them. Amen. What it is to be a Christian and how to live for him. Are y'all with me? Because any of us that have done it for any length of time, we all know that it's a learning process. Amen. And we're here now because we learned some lessons. And some of them were very hard lessons. But we made it. Amen, somebody. And we want our brother here to make it as well. So we're going to do all we can as a body to teach him also. Amen.
Abraham Hare is being baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit on this 16th day of August 2017 at Kingdom Connections Church of Mariana, Arkansas. Keith Roth, pastor.
Come on, Brother Abraham. Amen. Indeed. According to the commandment of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that has commanded us, instructed us that we baptize all new converts in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. And we know what this represents. Hallelujah. We know what this represents. Amen. A newness in Christ, a newness in his life. Amen. He's made a decision. Amen. That we all, most of all of us, have made in our life. And that is, we want to turn from how we were in the evil life we were living into a life anew. Amen. In Jesus' name. Come on, give the Lord a hand praise tonight. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. That being said, amen, we did quite a bit tonight. We did teaching and amen, and we had a baptism. Now let's take up this offering, amen. Praise the Lord and bless this offering, amen, so we can go home, amen, and begin to do things differently, to live things. I hope some of you will take away a spiritual lesson tonight. Amen, and begin to look. I know y'all didn't come to the altar, but I know some of y'all out there that identified with what I was saying. Okay, when you see evil spirits and evil stuff going on and happening around you, you need to take notice because it's a war going on 24/7, and if it ain't after you, it's after your children, it's after somebody else that you know. Amen, so you better be on guard and on point. If you need some help with that, then come see us, amen. We ain't scared. Y'all might be scared. You might be scared at this point in your life, but we're not scared of the devil. We're not scared of his evil forces because the Lord has told us that he is with us. Amen? And I'm a witness that no weapon shall prosper against us. Amen. Nothing that the enemy can show, nothing he can throw a hit our way is going to prosper. Amen.
Take a picture. She said, y'all ain't take no picture with me.
Amen. Praise God. Amen. While we're continuing to take up our offering and our convert is getting changed, thank God for our convert. The Holy Spirit, which is very intelligent, when Pastor was teaching on tonight, how many enjoyed the lesson on tonight? The Holy Spirit spoke to me, and I want to admonish especially our leaders. Leaders, listen carefully. This is a time for fasting and praying. Don't think that we're going to be taught on hell and not be tested on hell. Amen. 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 If you're scared, fast and pray and speak against the spirit of fear. Amen. Y'all got quiet there, so I'm going to leave that alone. But that's what the Holy Spirit gave me, so we're looking for. Amen. And we ain't scared. The devil can come, but he can't stay. Praise God. As we get ready to leave, I want to share an experience with you to confirm the word of God. About 11 years ago, I was living in Forest City. I was asleep on the couch. And well, I guess you know how you be halfway asleep, halfway woke, and my body, I could feel my body, Aunt Charles, literally trying to leave my body. And it scared me. The spirit of fear rose up immediately, and I rebuked it. About 4 years later, I was laying on the couch. I could hear the TV. I could hear the air conditioning. You know, you can just hear noise in your house. And again, I could feel my spirit literally lifting up. And this time I went up into the air, and I remember turning back to look at my body just as this author of the book. And I could see my body laying on the couch. Everything tuned out. I could still hear, feel, taste, see. As a matter of fact, my senses were magnified. And just as the author, before I could speak anything, God already would answer my questions. I asked, what is happening? God said, trust me. I noticed that my feet were floating higher than my head. And before I could even speak, I never spoke anything. Every time I would think it, God would answer my questions. Where I'm trying to take you, you can't get there from here. I need you to just follow me. And I kind of floated, and he said, I want to take you higher, but you're not ready. And I kind of just floated there a while, and I went back into my body. I said that, and I began to share this. I've shared it with my boys to me. I've never shared it publicly, and I shared it to confirm the word of God with the author on tonight, that spiritual warfare is real, and God wants to do things. Not all of it is wicked. There are spiritual is good and evil, and God would like to do things in our life. There are outer body experiences that we have in our home. And like Lady Ross, sometimes we contribute to just coincidences. Oh, that's just Carrie walking. But we have to always be praying for our discernment to be increased. So as Pastor teach on this, let us be fasting, let us be praying, and let us be watching. Give our candidate, a convert, a hand as he come back. Hey, man, come on up. Lady Ross got something she will present to you. Lady, come up. Stand right there, turn that way.
Oh, Pastor, come and get the picture. Of course, Elder said.
Let us stand. Amen. On the count of three, when I say unto one, I say unto all, watch and pray. God bless you. God be with you. You are dismissed.